Welcome to Fort Lee's first ever virtual installation town hall. My name is Stephen Baker and I'm the Director of Public Affairs for U.S. Army Garrison Fort Lee. Today's town hall is broadcasting live on Command Channel 14 in our local area and also online at www.lee.army.mil/townhall. Now, you might be asking, what makes this a virtual town hall? Well, we're here and you're there. Maybe in your office, maybe at home, maybe out and about. With technology nowadays, it's hard to tell. But the fact is, we're bringing this town hall to where you are, and just one of the many services the Garrison is bringing to you as a member of the Fort Lee community. Now, we've got a lot of questions to cover. We've received many questions in advance. We're going to be taking questions live through two methods. Those are email, armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil, and via Facebook, facebook.com/armyfortlee. The addresses there are on your screen. Just remember that if you post a question on Facebook, it is a public venue, so it will be visible to anybody who's on our page. If you want to send it privately, send a private message or send it to the email address. We are going to address as many of those questions as we can in the 1 hour broadcast portion of this virtual town hall. We'll also have the team here for about 30 minutes after it ends, answering questions and posting those answers online, Facebook, and via email, however it was received. And we'll be sending those responses out long after that, but if you've got some questions, there's a 30-minute window there right after this ends that you can get those in. At this time, I'm going to introduce the host of today's virtual town hall, our Garrison Commander, Colonel Paul Brooks.
Welcome, everybody, and thanks for signing on. And thanks, Stephen, for that introduction. Your orator skills never fail to amaze me. And I won't be answering all these questions by myself. We have an entire team of experts here. I have Command Sergeant Major Richardson, Garrison Command Sergeant Major, and Miss Melissa McGowan, the Deputy Garrison Commander here with us, as well as a number of our directors and subject matter experts in a number of different areas that we have. As stated, this is our first virtual town hall, and it's actually going to be incredible. We're very excited about how this one has actually started to pan out already. Before this broadcast even began, we received more community participation than we have in every previous town hall combined that we can actually remember. And that's what this is about. It's about hearing from you. And although we will put out some information as we go through this, the most important thing to note is this is not a Garrison infomercial. We're primarily here to answer your questions. This is your town hall, and we want to know what you're thinking. And based on input that we've already received, some of the topics that we will cover today will include changes in installation access procedures, how we decide to announce post-closings due to weather situations, FMWR activities, and a whole bunch more. We do have to keep on a pretty tight schedule, so we may have to move on from a topic or a subject matter expert as we go through this before we have an opportunity to answer all the questions. But as stated, there will be time at the end of this entire thing for additional questions, and we will also stay online afterwards so that we can ask follow or answer follow-on questions. So there's a lot to cover. So Stephen, let's get going.
In February, it was announced that Fort Lee would be joining many military installations across DOD in enacting new access control procedures. Now, these access control procedures will require anyone visiting the post to have a criminal background check if they don't have the required DOD or military ID to access the installation. That's generated a lot of concern and a lot of questions, understandably, and we're here to answer a lot of those today. A couple of questions are in the hands of the Garrison Commander. He's got one that we received via email before this broadcast and one received from Facebook. To answer those questions is our Director of Emergency Services, Mr. Tony DeWitt.
Thanks again, Stephen. Tony, how you doing?
Doing fine, sir.
That's awesome. All right, our first question from Facebook is about access control procedure changes. And actually, it's representative of many that we've gotten on this subject from a number of people. Will the base be accessible only with a common access card, and how does this affect Fort Lee's personnel and residents?
Sir, no, the base will not be only accessible with a CAT card, but in addition to the CAT card, we have the DD Form 2 for active duty, reserve, and retired personnel, the DD Form 1173 for active duty and retired personnel family members, and DD Form 1173-1 for reserve and National Guard family members. And sir, those personnel with these ID cards, our most frequent use ID cards, are part of what we call a trusted traveler program. they're authorized to come on post and vouch for up to 8 people in their vehicle with them without having to be vetted.
All right, and I understand we are doing Trusted Traveler right now and for a time being, but don't we also have periods in there while we're assessing the overall access situation where we have to shut down Trusted Traveler temporarily just to see who's coming on the installation?
Yes, sir, that's correct. Periodically, we must conduct traffic surveys to provide to our higher headquarters, and when we do that, we don't announce this, sir, because for security reasons, of course, but we do require at times 100% ID card checks.
And is that a temporary situation? We're eventually going to stop doing that at least as much as we are right now, right?
Yes, sir. Temporary, more so on a roving basis.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Next question was actually emailed to us from an Army civilian on Fort Lee. And he asks, we were told that our contractor employees would be vetted, backgrounds checked, and passes issued prior to implementation of the new gate access procedures. When will we start vetting our contractor personnel, and when will our management be informed of these timelines?
So first, I'd like to say the management have already been notified. They were notified a couple of weeks ago, and we asked them to provide us their list of contractors that must be vetted by Friday, March 13th. We are ready to receive those lists today. We're prepared to vet. We have been vetting names already. So that's one part of the questions answered. Another part is that the date you get the passes depends upon when we get the request from the contracting officer representative, because we anticipate a lot of requests being in the queue, so it depends on where you are in the queue once we get that list of names.
Okay, thanks, Tony.
We have questions now that we've received via Facebook. One of the first I'm going to ask here is, will these changes affect events on Fort Lee, like the fireworks? And that's presumptively the 4th at the Fort fireworks.
Stephen, yes, some events may be affected. However, 4th at the Fort may be one of those events the senior commander may waive those requirements for. If he should elect to waive those requirements, we would not vet personnel coming on post for that particular environment, for that particular event.
And aren't we also working some other initiatives so that AIT graduations, ALU graduations, and things along those lines, and I know they're only in the works, but to try and facilitate allowing family members on in a much more expeditious manner than would currently be available?
Yes, sir. Sir, we're gonna post those request forms on the Fort Lee website, so they'll be available for anybody coming to Fort Lee. They can download them, complete them, email them back to us at the Business Control Center. We will process them, and when the person comes on post, report to the Visitor Center, those passes should be ready for them to pick up. And sir, the duration of the length of the pass will depend upon the length of time here at Fort Lee.
Thanks, Tony.
All right, and here's a question coming from one of our fans on Facebook. She wants to know, how can I get a background check early to be able to conduct weekly health home visits with folks living in military housing?
Okay. Once we hang the post the forms on the Fort Lee website, this person can download it, complete the form, and drop it off at our Visitor Control Center. And once it's ready, we will give her a call or give him a call. Keep in mind, though, our priority for vetting background checks, first it goes to CAC-eligible employees, it goes to contractors, vendors, and then our volunteers and people in this category.
Right, and one last thing to understand that with respect to priorities is all DOD personnel, CAC-eligible, and non-CAC-eligible personnel that work on post who are in the process of being vetted, we should have at least temporary passes provided for all of those individuals before we actually change the procedures on the installation. And they should have a temporary pass at a minimum in hand.
And sir, let me add also that we're working on a capability to provide mobile support. For instance, the DPW, a lot of contractors, once we get those names and vet them, we plan to go to the DPW and issue passes and ID cards on the spot with our mobile capability.
Questions are coming in. Here's one we received just a couple minutes ago via email. I no longer drive and am brought in about 7:30 and picked up in the afternoon by a civilian who's retired from my agency. He no longer has a common access card. What has to be done to permit him to continue transporting me to and from work?
What this person will have to do, Stephen, is go by the Business Control Center, pick up the form, Fort Lee Form 190-3, complete the form, submit it back to the clerk. We'll conduct a background check, vet him, and issue a pass. And that pass may be long-term because of his sponsor. If it's on a daily basis, if his sponsor vouches for him and saying, this person needs to do this for X amount of time, we can provide a pass up to 1 year.
This is a number of questions, basically the same variation of this question coming in via Facebook. Essentially, quite a few folks out there want to know when these access passes will be provided to volunteers and others who don't have military IDs but frequently need to get on post.
For our volunteers, the sponsoring agencies should submit a Fort Lee form 190-2 to the Visitor Control Center with the names and all the pertinent information we need so we can complete the background check. Once those checks are complete, we'll prepare the passes and notify the sponsoring agency as to when they can be picked up.
Now, here's another question that's we've gotten a few on this topic. Folks want to know also, why has access to Fort Lee been so difficult lately with the construction on Sisiski Gate? Why haven't the other gate hours been changed to accommodate what's happening there?
It shouldn't be difficult to access Fort Lee, even with construction at Sisiski, but we got to keep in mind that the outbound lanes for Mahone and A Gate are single lanes. The two lanes at the Lee Gate, and the Sisiski Gate was a high-capacity two-lane exit road. So Sisiski had a high capacity for volume, whereas the other exit points do not. And so that's a contributing factor. And also, we did change the hours for Lee Gate from 05 to 29 hours in every day, 5 days a week. That's now our 24-hour gate, and that will remain our 24-hour gate until Sisiski Gate opens up. We've also extended the hours Shop Road Gate exit only from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday.
And here comes another gate question from Facebook. Why can't the Shop Road Gate be open on weekends until Sisiski is open again? And they want to know why the gates that aren't 24 hours can't be open longer in general.
Shop Road Gate is our commercial gate. And commercial gates are open 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, which we do. And we have a very limited number of resources to devote to our gates. And so our gate hours cannot extend longer than what they are now. Our traffic surveys justifies what we do now with our personnel. We do shift people around. I noted earlier that we open Shop Road Monday through Fridays now from 4 to 6 p.m. because we are moving assets from one gate to another gate to make this happen.
And here's a question completely away from the topic of gates, and I would be asking this one too. Could the skunk infestation on Ordnance Campus be addressed? They say they're chasing skunks out of the PT pad before the soldiers get out there.
The skunks are returning to the natural habitat. But of all seriousness, please give us a call, 734-7400 to our game warden, and we'll do our best to trap those skunks and take them away from the PT pits and from their troop areas. And since you mentioned skunks, Stephen, and animals, stray cats. We do have an issue with stray cats here in Fort Lee, and so we would ask that our people on Fort Lee not feed our cats. Let the game warden take care of the cats. Give us a call for the problem. Now, we've gotten comments from ICE comments regarding cats walking on people's POVs, on their hoods, on their tracking across the top of their cars, and upset some folks. So please give us a call, and we'll do our best to take care of the cat problem for you.
Thank you. For the moment, that's all the time we have for our Director of Emergency Services, Mr. Tony DeWitt. We are continuing to answer questions throughout this live broadcast. Please keep sending in your questions. We have some more questions asked that fall into the realm of the emergency services arena. We're going to be answering those online, just like all the others that we're receiving today. Now, one thing I want you to know is that you can submit your questions two ways. The addresses are right behind me. The email is armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil. And you can also submit, if you're just tuning in, via Facebook, facebook.com/armyfortlee. Those are two ways that you can get your questions to us. We're monitoring both of those channels right now and taking those questions and incorporating that into our program live as we're here. Now, the next questions we're going to be addressing and comments were really inspired by Jack Frost. He's been nipping at our heels this winter. If you've been on post, you know that we've had closings of the installation, delayed openings, and an early release. Now, that is generated a lot of questions and concern, and you know, people want to know about the procedures and the reasons we close or how we decide to make a change to our operational status. Our deputy to the garrison commander, Ms. Melissa McGowan, has a question on that that she's received from online, and she's going to be asking that of Mr. Scott Brown, our director of plans, training, mobilization, and security.
We did seem to receive a number of questions related to weather, and the question that people want to know is, when there is severe winter weather forecasted for the next day, why does Fort Lee wait so long to make a decision on a closing or delay? Also, some folks on Facebook noted that other installations like Joint Base Langley-Eustis seem to announce their decisions far earlier than Fort Lee. So Scott, if you could address that, please.
Yes. Fort Lee, we monitor the weather 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in the installation operations center. And what we do with the weather is, as we track the weather and monitor the weather, we go into mission analysis and we come up and formulate how that weather is going to impact Fort Lee. And by doing that, we bring in what's called the Crisis Action Team, which is a group of subject matter experts across the installation to include the tenant organizations, so everyone has a part in helping to make this decision on the impact of Fort Lee. We not only look at Fort Lee in and of itself, but also our surrounding communities, our road networks, and the uniqueness about Fort Lee is that we sit in a very unique area with the mountains to our west and the ocean to our east. So what happens is a lot of times the weather patterns are a little strange, where if the storm comes up out of the south, we normally have more of an ice type event. If the storm comes from the north, we normally have more of a snow type event. So what we like to do is continue with our battle rhythm, get the crisis action team together, and then when we make that mission analysis, we provide that information to the garrison commander, and he then takes that information to get with the senior commander, and then we decide on how we're going to impact the post with a delayed opening, close for the day. But the key to all of this is once again, is to allow us to take the time to do the proper mission analysis on this any particular weather event.
And part of our analysis also, Scott, is actually looking at what other installations are doing, isn't it?
Yes, sir. 100% correct, sir. We ensure that we look at both the installations to our north and to our east, because Fort Lee has a large commute area. We have the Hampton Roads area that comes up out of the east. We have those that are as far north as the Fredericksburg area coming down. We have workers out of Charlottesville, and we also have those that come right across the North Carolina border. So we have a large area that we're looking at when we take that into consideration.
So, and that's primarily not because of what's happening right here on Fort Lee, but because of our personnel's commute and the potential hazards of them driving in or leaving in that weather, right?
Yes, sir.
We have another question on this topic. This individual, she wants to know on Facebook, why doesn't the post close if schools are closed? And she is referring to schools off post. We don't all have childcare.
Once again, that is a great question from our community. Once again, Fort Lee happens to sit in an area where we have our young children in about 100 plus different schools. So when a school happens to close, they go through the same analysis to determine how they're going to execute that closing. So when we look at that, just the same as the schools, we look at how long the kids will be out at the bus stops, what's the impacts on the roads, but not necessarily because a particular school closed will that cause the installation to close. But we take all of that into consideration when we put all that together to decide on the closure of Fort Lee. But the beauty of Fort Lee is that the senior commanders have always decided to use in concert with that when it's necessary to use liberal leave to allow our employees the opportunity to take leave if they have these type of situations.
All right. We have a question. This one was received both via email and Facebook from an Army civilian here on Fort Lee. Thank you for the questions, and please keep these coming in. She wants to know why it takes so long for the U.S. Enterprise Emergency System to notify us of delays, closings, etc., and why is information able to get out on Facebook so much quicker? She says, for example, an accident closing on I-95 happened about 1:30, but she didn't receive notification until close to or after 4 p.m.
I'm excited to answer that question. I would like to start out with is that we at Fort Lee were excited to receive the Army's Enterprise Solution on Notification Systems. We call it the Lee Alert, better known as Ad Hoc. And we received that back in July of 2014, was able to get it fully operational in the Emergency Center in September of 2014. And in the process of doing that, what we have there is that if you happen to be at your computer and you have your CAT card in your computer, it will pull up the ability to give you those alerts when we send them out at your desktop and your work telephone, which are those items that are registered in the system. But now here's where we need your help at. On the self-registration part of the Ad Hoc and Lee Alert system is that you can go in and register your mobile device. And by doing that, you can receive messages via text message. You can get voice messages on your cell phone, your BlackBerry, or any type of mobile device that you may have. And you can also put in your home email, your home phone number. And that gives us a greater capability to reach out and touch you. And we also, while we're in the process of that, we monitor our national news networks. We also rely on our military police to provide us information. We rely on the community. The community plays a big part on calling into the operations center and providing us that type of information so we can validate it, vet it, and yes, we would love to get that information out on the emergency notification system. And that's just one of several systems that we have that we're able to provide that type of information to you.
And if I could tag on to that, too, Ad Hoc is an absolutely great system. But, you know, with the nature of social media today, Ad Hoc is a method for us to get information out. The virtue, the way social media works is there could be somebody sitting at that accident on I-95, and they're already putting it on Facebook or Twitter and somebody or something along those lines. Before we can actually disseminate the information, we have to get it in, investigate it, and verify it before we can actually put anything out. And unfortunately, we don't have the speed with which to verify that information nearly as fast as we would like to in a number of instances. And we're never going to be as fast as somebody sitting on the ground using social media to pass information out. And we can't just take the first feed we see and send that out to everybody as the gospel truth. What we're going to do is we have to verify it, put it into Ad Hoc or a similar system, Leaky, something along those lines, and then get that information out.
Yes, sir.
All right. We have time for just one more quick question, and this is one I'd like to know the answer to. It's piqued my curiosity. Why is the Fort Lee PA/intercom system messed up? It always sounds like a fax machine or someone dialing numbers.
And once again, the community is asking some great questions. And what you have there is that our external voice or tower system uses a system DTMF, almost like my initials to the organization I work for. But this is called the dual tone multi-frequency, which is a system that works similar to a keypad. And what it does is it's dialing up to the towers and sending the tone to the towers to say, are you ready? And then the tower responds back to the system saying, yes, I'm ready. So that's the sound that you're hearing is the system queuing up each of those towers because we have them in groups where we can sound single towers or all the towers at one time. Since we're on that topic, a good news story to that also is that here in the next couple of months, we're going to have the contractor come in and to relook at all of our towers. Right now, they're currently analog systems, and we're looking at bringing those on to be digital systems. And we'll see then whether or not the dual tone multi-frequency, maybe that tone, we can tone it down just a little bit. But keep in mind that when you hear that tone, that's about to give you some sort of alert. So it's also another positive at the same time.
All right, great information, Scott. Thanks a lot. It's good to know the answer to that. And there are some fantastic questions that we've received. We've been getting some today and all throughout this past week. We appreciate your participation. Please know it's not too late to send in a question. You can still get it to us via email, armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil, or on Facebook, facebook.com/armyfortlee. We're excited to be answering all of these fantastic questions and responding to your comments. And we're going to answer some some more here coming up, but first I want to tell you a little bit about a resource you might not know about. It's the Fort Lee Community Resource Guide, and that's accessible at www.lee.army.mil/crg. Now, what is it? Well, it's a comprehensive list of health and wellness resources located on post, and in the next year or so, it will be expanded to also include relevant off-post services. Now, the great thing about this guide is that it's searchable by category. That means you don't have to know who's offering the services, just what service you need. You can also search it optionally by organization or through an A to Z list if you know which organization you're seeking. And a really neat part of this is an audience filter. So you can filter by whether you're a service member, a family member, a civilian contractor, a retiree, and it will only display to you the services that are applicable to you as an individual. At this time, we're going to move on, and I'm going to introduce our Director of Public Works, Mr. Gregg Williams. He's going to be answering a question on a variety of topics because, let's face it, if you park on it, drive on it, or work in it, DPW is probably supporting it on Fort Lee. The first question is going to be asked and is in the hands of our Command Sergeant Major, CSM Clarence Richardson.
Thanks, Steve. You know, there's a lot of curiosity about the quick convenience access to our commissary in PX. So Greg, our Facebook question for DPW. Everybody's in everybody's mind as they enter and exit the installation, what's the deal with the construction at the 60 gate, and do we have any idea when it'll be complete and operational?
That's a really good question. As a matter of fact, I think Sergeant Major got this one because Greg's here, sick of hearing me ask this exact same question.
Sir, Sergeant Major, I'll be happy to respond to that question. For the Sisiski Gate project, this is the first time we've used this particular contractor. We had a few startup challenges, but we got through that. And once we got through that startup challenge, then we got hit by a couple of weather delays. As you know, we had two significant storms that shut the post down for about 2 or 3 days. The good news is that right now we're on track to have this project completed by mid to late April. So I appreciate everybody's patience so far. I ask for your patience for a little bit longer. And again, remember, at the end of the day, it's about us getting our guards, our first responders, out of the inclement weather and taking care of the people that take care of us.
Right. We have another question for Mr. Williams. This is coming in from Facebook. This individual user, she wants to know, or she comments, that Fort Bliss has solar panels on nearly all of their housing units and several other buildings as well. She says that though we don't enjoy quite as much sun, she wants to know, is Fort Lee considering doing anything like this?
Whenever we do any major military construction, we always consider energy savings type projects. Solar panels have been considered for our family housing units. They've also been considered for our new barracks construction. But so far, we've not found these to be cost effective for us here at Fort Lee. However, we have used solar panels on our water heaters. We've also used solar panels on our exterior mass notification systems. And we also use solar panels on our pedestrian alert flashers.
This next question is from Facebook, and sir, thank you for asking this question. It's one that, as a parent, I've asked plenty of times at home. This is one that applies installation-wide, and you wanted to know, why are there so many lights on at night on the installation? A lot of money could be saved if those were turned off.
That's an excellent question. We're actually mandated to do 3% energy reduction from 2005 through 2015. Most of our buildings, the interior lighting is manually controlled. So we lean on the tenants in these buildings to turn the lights out when they leave the buildings. All buildings are supposed to have an appointed building energy monitor, and that's one of the responsibilities of the building energy monitor, is to make sure that the lights are off or make sure there's a program in place to make sure the lights are off. And just a reminder to the people out in the buildings, every dollar we save in energy, that's more dollars we can use for maintenance and repair of our installation.
And speaking of maintenance and repair of our installation, this next question from one of our Facebook users is, when will the Soldier Support Center parking lot lines get repainted? She says it's causing traffic problems there.
Every year after our winter season, my team does a survey of all the parking lots and also any other building facilities damages. And then we prepare a work prioritization list, and then we accomplish this work throughout the summer. We'll typically do the striping for the Soldier Support Center and like buildings in the summer months. So it, again, it's our goal to have that parking lot striped before the end of October of this year.
We've also received questions from some of our residents in Fort Lee Family Housing. One of them came in via Facebook, and it is, when can German Shepherds and Boxers be allowed to live on post?
Actually, our Fort Lee leasing policy does not prohibit Boxers or German Shepherds. There are certain breeds that are prohibited from being on post, and I recommend that you check with your leasing manager to see which pets are not allowed on post.
Okay. And here's one also coming in from Facebook. Got a couple questions from this individual. The first is, why is everything on one side of post? Can't we get a shop at a gas station somewhere near the ALU or PWD side?
That's an excellent question. And in our real property long-range master plan, we actually have a location sited near Larkin Hall off of A Avenue in Sisiski for a shopette and a small service station. This would be a AFES project, therefore we would need to get the funding from AFES to do the what's a non-appropriated funded military construction project. So we're in dialogue with AFES for them to try to program to fund this project in a future year.
And the second question this individual had, why are there so many reserve parking spaces in front of the commissary? I see a lot of older veterans that can barely walk because there's no handicap spots available, so they have to park in the employee side of the parking lot. Individual states that only the post commander, CSM, and handicapped individuals and pregnant females should have a reserved parking space.
I've actually heard that concern in the past, and at this installation we have a traffic review board that vets all traffic-related concerns. And the board makes recommendation to the Garrison Commander, and it's the Garrison Commander's final decision on all traffic control issues to include reserved parking. So this is one that if the person wants to contact my office to have us add it to the traffic review board agenda, we'll do that and we'll vet it with the traffic review board and we'll have the conversation with the Garrison Commander on whether or not we should change the reserve parking at the commissary.
Right, and correct me if I'm wrong, Gregg, but in the past year alone, I think we've already made some parking lot adjustments, and I can't remember off the top of my head which ones we actually did reserve parking changes to, but the bottom line of that too is every tenant on the installation has the ability to provide input or recommendations to that traffic control review board, and we will definitely look at what they're talking about and take everything that they have to talk about into consideration.
Yes, sir, you're exactly right. And we're also updating our traffic management regulation with our Director of Emergency Services. And once we update that regulation, it'll explain the process of how to get reserve parking, and that'll be available on the Fort Lee command page.
All right. Thank you, Gregg. Now, before we move on to our next segment, I want to tell you that the next two comments that are going to be addressed did not come from either email or Facebook. They came from the Interactive Customer Evaluation System, ICE. And this kind of ICE is nice, and I'll tell you why. If you haven't used ICE before, you can check it out on the Fort Lee website. That's www.lee.army.mil. Scroll down to the bottom, and you'll see that little blue ICE logo there. You click on that, and it will take you to the ICE site where you can send us your question, concern, complaint, or compliment. We'll take compliments, too. Your message will go directly to the person or organization responsible for the service you're commenting on, and the great thing is that it will be addressed because we are required, if you request a response and include your contact information, to respond within 3 days. So the one thing to note is that while you can submit anonymously, we do ask that you include your contact information and request a response. Why? Well, if you have an issue that needs to be addressed and we need to follow up and get more info to do that, it's going to help us to get in contact with you and actually reach a resolution. Now, again, this town hall is being broadcast live, and there are two ways that you can submit questions to us. Right behind us, behind me, are the addresses. It's there on your screen now. armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil is the email address to submit your questions, or you can do it via Facebook, facebook.com/armyfortlee. Now, this time, I'm going to introduce Bill Butcher. He's our Director of Family and Morale, Welfare, and Recreation. He's going to be answering quite a few questions that have been received regarding the services and activities offered by FMWR. The Deputy of the Garrison Commander has those first two comments that were received via ICE, and I just want to note that even though we received those via ICE, these two in particular received a lot of repeat on social media. They were echoed there pretty widely, so these are a couple comments that we know you have concerns on and that are going to be addressed.
Thank you, Stephen. I'd like to reiterate Stephen's comments on ICE. We use ICE as our customer evaluation tool to find out more about what our customers like, don't like, to improve our processes, to change programs, and in general, to find out what's going on the installation. We do like positive comments, as he said. It's always good to tell us what we're doing right as well as what you don't like. So I read them all. I'd ask you to continue to give us your ICE comments because it helps us to get better at what we do. Our first ICE comment that I'm going to turn over to Bill has to do with the dog park. It says, I think that Fort Lee would greatly benefit from an on-post dog park. I know that many families would even be willing to contribute monetarily to the upkeep of such a facility. Now, I will tell you, I've seen this on ICE several times, so I think that Bill might have an answer that some of you are going to like.
Yeah, great news story for our four-legged friends. The Garrison Commander has authorized us to put in a dog park. That park's going to be right behind the P-Extra, the Holiday Helper, and the Bowling Center in a field there. Close proximity for our family members in housing to walk their pets down. We're in the process now. In fact, we went out and measured the location a couple of days ago, and we're in the process of solidifying the contract for establishing the park. And then we don't need monetary support from you. Thank you very much for the offer. What we need is your participation in making sure that we keep it clean and safe. We'll post rules out in front of the dog park, and then we just ask our family members, our patrons here on Fort Lee to support as best you can that facility.
Thank you. Our second comment from ICE, Fort Lee does not provide adequate fitness center access for the number of soldiers, retirees, and civilians that try to use them. Facilities cannot accommodate its patrons during peak hours when we are both open. Many soldiers are forced to look off post for gym membership due to overcrowded facilities on post.
Yeah, and this is another area where both the post commander and the garrison commander have directed us to find solutions, and we certainly know that there is overcrowding in our facilities. What we've done and what we're doing. What we've done already, we've started McLaughlin Gym is now open at 0500 in the morning as opposed to 5:30. Clark Gym is opened at 4:30 to help alleviate some of that overcrowding. We've established a CrossFit, a functional fitness facility at the Post Field House. That opened up on May 9th thanks to our Director of Public Works for getting that accomplished.
March 9th.
And what we're doing eagerly is putting together a cardio fitness facility as part of the Post Field House. We won't mess with the basketball courts. Those remain just as they are, but we'll establish cardio fitness locations within the Post Field House that alleviate some of the overcrowding from that component. And then finally, and I think most importantly, we've responded to an Army Family Action Plan issue about having full-time fitness and free fitness. We're putting a mobile fitness on demand system in a racquetball court within the Post Field House again, and the patron can come in push the button and do any type of fitness that they want in that facility in the near future. That has been purchased and we're waiting for its arrival.
All right, Bill, you said the CrossFit just opened a few days ago, actually. Do we have any semblance of a timeline for when some of the other stuff is actually going to become available?
Well, I think in terms of the cardio fitness facility, we're presently getting some of the storage equipment that we have in there out and working with DPW on what that will look like specifically. We have funding available for it, so it's not a resource issue in this case. It's an issue of prioritization of projects into that location, and I suspect that by midsummer or late summer, we'll have that up and running completely. I also want to make a point that we're looking at expanding Clark Gym. There's about a 2,300 square foot expansion that we plan on doing with Clark, and that will help alleviate some of both the cardio and the weight facility problems that we presently have.
Thanks, Bill.
Now, we've got quite a few questions here because people love their fitness and they love their activities and getting out and being energetic on Fort Lee. And here's a great one considering spring and summer are coming up. Can we get an indoor year-round pool? What about swimming classes on post?
Okay, well, let me address the swimming classes. Of course, first, our pool is open right now from Memorial Day to Labor Day. And swimming classes start immediately upon the opening of the pool itself. But I do want to talk about something that we're looking eagerly at doing. We are in the process now of determining the possibility of making a full-time, a year-round facility out of our pool by putting in an enclosure. That is unresourced at this present time, but there are resources that we've identified that we anticipate receiving for that. And then that will allow, you know, full-time swimming, swimming lessons, and of course our family members, soldiers and family members and civilians to use that resource all year round.
Here's a comment from an individual on Facebook. He wants to know why Fort Lee doesn't have an FMWR-funded warrior zone, a warrior zone with games, computers, a movie room, and a food ordering concession area that soldiers can go to on the weekends.
Well, that's a great question, and it's one that, I love these questions. There are things that we are in the process of responding to. In fact, on the 7th of April, we're going to try to meet with the senior leaders of the Advanced Individual Training and demonstrate for them what it is that we can provide, particularly to our AIT soldiers, in terms of a warrior zone resource. And it will include all of the components that have been discussed.
Here's a question. Now, actually, this is a question that's representative of several questions we've received on Facebook. Folks want to know if you could make Fort Lee a bit more family-friendly by having children in the gym, and they ask that in two senses, a child care for kids at the gym and also kids working out at the fitness facilities.
Well, let me answer the easier one first. In terms of children, dependents working out in our facilities, they certainly can. Age 13 to 16 have to be with a supervisor, an adult supervisor. And then 16 and beyond can use our facilities at will. The other question is a little bit more of a question related to child care. Now, we can't use our facilities because of strict regulation, our fitness facilities, for child care. That's done at our child development center. And what we are working eagerly to do is to hire CDC workers, child development center workers, to expand on our ratio and allow us opportunities for greater hourly care. We know it's a concern in the community. We know the community would like to have offered additional hourly care, and we're working hard on that. I need your help in that. If you are looking for a job and you want to work in our child development center, we would invite you to usajobs.gov, search Fort Lee, look for MWR jobs, and you'll find CDC positions in there that we would love for you to apply to.
We have a question now from an individual on Facebook. She would like to know, how well are the local school systems doing to accommodate military school-aged children? Also, what specifically can they do to make the transition better for children starting a new school?
So, retired military myself, and I know the struggles and the care that needs to go into ensuring that our children get oriented properly into new school systems. We presently meet with the superintendent of schools, with Garrison Commander, Deputy Garrison Commander, on a bi-monthly basis. And I'm impressed by the superintendent and how much he cares about the military child and the fact that he talks about the diversity and culture that the military child brings to those schools. He also has a great program in place at Prince George County Schools that is called Student to Student, which allows a student to be mentored by another student and introduced into the school system. And by the way, Chesterfield County Schools have the same program. So I encourage our soldiers and families to use that resource and also use our student liaison officer, Ms. Chandra Taswell, to ensure that she's engaging on their behalf.
All right, there's a question now that came in via email, and again, that email address
can
is...
Can I jump back to that one? Just to highlight...
Yes, sir.
Just to highlight and caveat on what Bill was talking about with respect to what Dr. Browder, the superintendent over there at Prince George, is doing, and their definitive concern for trying to take care of our students over here. They've actually taken money out of their own budget to bring personnel over here to Memorial Chapel and actually do tutoring classes on the installation so that our students can actually walk to the tutoring, do that stuff right there, and walk back to their home in housing so they don't have to worry about getting a ride out there or something along those lines and trying to find a ride out there, a ride back, and take care of themselves. And they're actually taking that out of hide, bringing administrators and student teachers in here to help us along those lines.
Yes, sir, that's correct. And it's right now 6th and 7th grade, and it's math. Those critical years for children for ensuring their effectiveness in academics.
Anyway, this next question comes in via email. Again, that's armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil to submit via email, or facebook.com/armyfortlee. The question is from a DA civilian, and he would like to know, or his comment is, every year, the youth basketball season runs from January to March in the Post Fieldhouse. Now, the culinary arts competitive training event occurs every year toward the middle or end of the season at the Post Fieldhouse. During that 2 to 3 week period, none of the teams are able to practice. Many parents choose to go elsewhere as a result, which he feels is not good for the Fort Lee program. After so many years of this, he wants to know why some kind of accommodation or agreement can't be made with other facilities on or off post to support the kids during this time period.
Yeah, I'll just say I certainly agree with him. There is solutions that we can find to this situation so that child youth sports aren't disrupted. We care about our children and certainly their athletic programs here. One thing with 10-foot regulation goals shouldn't be a problem in the future. We could use other facilities to do that. And then for those 8-foot goals, we just need to make sure we're finding other solutions, maybe our teen center or our school age services. We have to do some work on that, but by next season, we'll certainly have an answer.
This next question comes from Facebook again, and she wants to know, can you include the Army Reserve Family Program representatives into on-post meetings to better serve the reserve soldiers and families who live and work in the area?
Yeah, great point. I mean, there's no doubt that what we're here to do is serve all of our service members to the best of our ability. There is a quarterly community activities council that occurs here. In fact, one just met. That outlines everything that's going on our installation. That would be a great resource for our Army Reserve and National Guard representatives to attend in the future.
Okay. This next question is regarding childcare, and the individual on Facebook, appears to be numerous comments that have been made. They want to know, why isn't school age or infant hourly care available at the CDC during PT hours? They say that family child care providers get sick, plan vacations, change hours, and close. And, you know, they say most civilian daycare doesn't open before 6 or 6:30 a.m.
Well, certainly here in our community, our child care hours open up at 5:15 so that we can make sure that soldiers get to PT on time. But there's a broader issue than that. I mean, I know what's being represented here is that hourly care, and it goes back to that, the crux of the problem of having the number of child development center workers that we can build a ratio that allows us to do our full-time and part-time and then hourly care as well. I will say that that anyone who lives in any community around here who's an authorized patron can use our child development centers.
As long as we have slots available. And it goes back to what Bill has been talking about the entire time. The crux of the entire problem in that for us is the ability to bring the requisite number of properly vetted and capable child care providers to the installation. Because we have mandated ratios with respect to age and number of instructors or care providers that we have, and we're not allowed to exceed that ratio.
Sure.
A question now coming from a lady on Facebook who would like to know why Fort Lee does not have a Special Olympics team for children.
Well, that's a great question, and that's certainly one that that we need to look into. We have a tremendous, exceptional family member program here. Program coordinator Judy Eoff is passionate about the support to our exceptional family members. And it's something I'll take up with her to see if there's a way that we can encourage that in the future.
Okay. And the question now about schools again. Why can't Fort Lee employees whose children attend Prince George County Schools have their children bused to the OnPost Youth Center?
Well, for those students who attend Prince George County Schools, we do have a planned program in place where we can pick up students in those schools and bring them back to our after-school programs. That has been resourced, and it's something that we hope to have in place by the next academic year.
Okay. All right, we've got our final questions coming up next. I want to remind you that even though our program is drawing to a close here, we've got about 9 minutes left in the broadcast portion, you can keep asking questions at armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil. Send questions to that email address or online facebook.com/armyfortlee. And we're going to continue answering those questions even after this broadcast ends. That is the beauty virtual town hall. We're going to remain connected, and really anytime at the public affairs office, our job is to make sure that our publics, including especially our on-post publics, our community here at Fort Lee, is very well informed of what's going on. So we're always available to answer questions. Just send them in and we'll work to get those answers to you. Now, before we move on with the program, I want to tell you about one more program, one more service you might not be aware of on Fort Lee, and that's the Army Wellness Center, which opened up recently on Mahone Avenue in building 9205. Now, the Army Wellness Center offers physical and health assessments, along with classes and coaching that are designed to help you lead healthier lifestyles. Now, those services are available to active duty military and family members, ages 18 and up, retirees, spouses, DOD civilians, reservists, and National Guard. And it's important to note for you soldiers out there that information gained about you from during appointments at the Army Wellness Center is protected by HIPAA. That means you cannot be flagged based on those assessments. So if you need more information, go ahead and call the AWC at 734-9925. Again, we've got a few more questions here that we're going to address, and these are for our command team and some of our directors who are still here in the studio to answer them. This is going back, this was received via email. This is going back to the issue of installation access. And so this will be answered by our Director of Emergency Services, Mr. Tony DeWitt. This individual who works on post, she wants to know, what happens if I accidentally leave my common access card at my desk and leave the installation, say for lunch? How do I get back on post? Do I have to have a background check?
No, you won't need a background check. However, you may need to call someone to have them meet you at the visitor control center with the ID card. That's the best way to get back on post. Short of that, you may have to get better with the background check, but I would encourage you to have someone meet you at the visitor control center with your CAT card.
Okay. And we have another question here on this. Via email, our group booked the Lee Club for a big event next month. What happens when we have 100 visitors coming to the gate at one time at 5 o'clock or 5:30 as a start time?
First of all, if your guests are military members that have the proper identification, not a problem for those folks. For others who are not vetted, we need you to complete a Fort Lee Form 3 for a group. It captures information for groups of people to come on post. We can get that list up front and we can vet them and we can have those passes available. But I would encourage you to make contact or call our Business Control Center so we can work out the details. So we can assist you. We want your event to go off very well. We want everybody to be there on time. So we may have to, you may have to contact us so we can work out the details and take care up front with that.
Right, and one thing, the two aspects of that, the one thing that can help that situation holistically is trusted traveler. So if, as Tony was talking about, if you have CAC or ID card holders who are able to come on the installation and you're allowed to create a mix of personnel along those lines and utilize the Trusted Traveler program, that can help facilitate it. But the other big piece of that is the prior coordination to ensure if we have the information before they start showing up, we can start running those background checks or doing whatever it is that's required and facilitate a quick entry when the actual event does come up.
We have a question now. This is going to be for our Director of Public Works, Mr. Gregg Williams. This is an employee on post, and she would like to know, because she enjoys shopping at the Fort Lee Thrift Shop, she's finding it very hard to maneuver or park safely due to folks parking in the middle of the lot, not in marked spaces. She wants to know if parking there can be reviewed to reline it and create a better design.
That's something we definitely can investigate, and I'll work with my staff to look at how we can maximize the space that we have, and I'll provide a more detailed response to this answer on Facebook for PAO to disseminate it.
Thank you. And here comes a question. I believe this will be right for the command team. Via Facebook, this individual, he wants to know why NCOs get briefed to not make corrections when it's involving advanced individual training students and soldiers. Believes that on-the-spot corrections need to be allowed.
Well, Stephen, I'll take that one. That's an interesting question, and actually, I'm actually curious to know where that's coming from. Because as leaders, you're expected to make those on-the-spot corrections with anyone. Especially for our younger generation of service men and women. As it applies to setting standards or good order and discipline. And I would tell you a caveat to that though is, you know, as long as it's just that, an on-the-spot correction. If there's a need to administer corrective training or punishment of some sort, that is where trade out regulation 350-6 comes into play and addresses corrective training and punishment for the initial entry soldiers. Now, if you're recommending making those corrections to our joint services, men and women, then I would suggest that you take that up with their command by going through your chain of command. And then we'll see where it goes from there.
We're approaching the end of our program. We have time to ask one more question that we've received, and this one comes via Facebook, and we'll have to address this right to Colonel Brooks. Sir, this individual wants to know, what is the Garrison Commander's number one priority?
Well, we have a ton of priorities here in the Garrison, and the biggest thing we're here for is to ensure that everything that we do is facilitating a better living / working environment for all of our military, civilians, and family members that are on the installation. That being said, all the directors on this installation, everybody in our chain of command, and all the other 10 units that we work with, we need to ensure that we do all of that in a safe and secure environment. If we're not providing a safe and secure environment for all of our employees and all of our family members and everybody who lives and works on this installation, we're missing the boat. So that's our number one priority.
Thank you, everyone who's tuned into this broadcast today. Again, this was our first ever virtual town hall. If we did a great job, please let us know. If there were things that we could have done better, let us know that as well. We've given you a few ways to get in contact with us. armyfortlee.pao@mail.mil is a great email address. You can also comment on Facebook, and you learned a little bit today about ICE, the Interactive Customer Evaluation System. This broadcast will be archived in a recording available at www.lee.army.mil/townhall, so you can see it there later. And remember, we're still going to be answering all of the rest of the questions we didn't get to online, and it will also be including answers to those questions we did answer today. Now, to close things out, I'm turning it back over to our Garrison Commander, Colonel Paul Brooks.
All right, first thing I would like to do is thank everybody who took the time to log on, watch, and participate, ask questions, things along those lines. Really appreciate everybody's input to this. It's great to see everybody showing an interest in their community and what's going on around us. Bottom line for us also, as we move forward, let us know what you think, how you think this entire thing went. If you want to see something different, let us know about it. If you want to discuss different topics, let us know about it. Well, we plan to continue to do these things in the future as we move forward, so we would really like to be able to focus our efforts on what's important to the community and everybody else out there. Your feedback is important to us, just like with ICE and everything else. That's what drives the train behind how we do business and how we resource everything that we're trying to accomplish. As stated already, we'll stay in line, take questions for about 30 more minutes. Once again, appreciate everybody for signing on. Have a great day.
All right, thank you again. And we'll see you at our next virtual installation town hall. Have a great day.